Elite CISO's Power Podcast. This week, listen into an interesting discussion around cyber insurance. Hello, everyone. Welcome to yet another episode of Elite CISO's Podcast. And this week, we are going to talk about cyber insurance. And to talk about on this subject, we have Mr. T.L. Arunachalam, who is the Director, Specialty Lines and Liability Risk at Bharat Reinsurance. So welcome to the show, Mr. Arun. Go ahead and introduce yourself, please.
Hi, everybody. Glad to see you on Elite CISO's platform. I'm very happy to share with you my experience on cyber insurance for the benefit of members of Elite CISO's. My name is T.L. Arunachalam. I've been in the insurance industry for 30 years now. I've worked across organizations, and my overall specialization has been non-life insurance in various functions, which is marketing, underwriting, and claims. For the past 6 years, I've been focusing on cyber insurance, which has given me a lot of interest and confidence in advising corporates. I'm a lawyer by qualification, and that has also helped me to understand the nuances of what kind of legal challenges a customer would face, especially when there's a liability claim made on them.
Right, right. Wonderful. So, you know, we are in lockdown. Like you said, Chennai, there's still a lockdown going on. And we have seen that during this COVID-19 times, there's a lot of attack, online attack happening on the organization. So hackers are sitting at home and they are attacking different organizations. So this becomes, you know, very, very important to understand the overall nuances of cyber insurance. So what I wanted to do is I wanted to set a quick context. So if you allow me, let me share my screen. I just want to share a couple of data points. Let me know when you see my screen, please.
Yeah.
Great. So if you look at the screen right now, talking about the Indian insurance market, what it talks about is it's about $280 billion industry in 2020 itself, right? And the life insurance coverage is kind of expanding about 12 to 15% annually. So we are seeing a huge growth when it comes to life insurance. But when we talk about cyber insurance, it does not even exist. If you look at the other segment, which are non-life insurance. So we are talking about the motor vehicle insurance, health insurance, crop insurance, fire insurance and all. And again, it's also a huge market in itself. But cyber insurance, it does not even exist over there, right? And I picked up this study, this snapshot from a study conducted by Partner RE and Edvison. It's a good study and a very recent one in 2019, they conducted it. And what they're talking about is, what is the biggest obstacle, right, for selling the cyber insurance, right? Because we are not seeing a growth in the market. So first one, what they're saying is not understanding the exposure. So organizations, they do not understand what their exposure is, first of all. And then second is, they do not understand the coverage, what a cyber insurance policy can provide. So all in all, what I feel, even being a CISO, I see in the market, the clarity and the knowledge on overall cyber insurance is kind of missing. So that's why I wanted to, you know, talk to somebody in the cyber insurance domain who is kind of expert, who is doing it day in and day out. So I'm thankful to our common friend, Mr. Ganeshan, who introduced me to you, saying
Ganpati,
right. So we never met. It's a community where I share all these podcasts, and he went through a couple of them and suggested that you have got great knowledge about cyber insurance. So we said okay, let's get on this podcast. So thanks a lot for accepting the invite and talking to our audience.
My pleasure.
Great. Coming back to the first question. First of all, what is cyber insurance? Why I am asking this is because still there is no clarity in terms of insurance. So help us define, what do you mean by cyber insurance in itself?
Because thank you for the question. It sets a very good foundation to understand the importance of cyber insurance for a corporate. I want to clarify to you that my focus has been to advise corporates on cyber insurance. Of course, I understand what individuals would be facing as exposure, on their life, digital life, and what kind of issue they may face. But my existence and my value to my customers had been, I'm advising corporates as to what kind of exposure they may have from the cyberspace and how it can impact business, and finally how it can impact their balance sheet. Now, if you look at risk as it is, any organization would have risk in different ways. Like you would have seen fire accident happening, massive fire recently in Gujarat,
right?
1,000 crore expected loss. Physical assets being exposed to such hazard, including flood and earthquake, is one issue. Secondly, they may have business losses, which can be a trade loss or anything related to financial loss, anything related to foreign exchange loss. There are a lot of risks to which a corporate would be exposed.
Mm-hmm.
Among those risks, there's a larger classification of risk called liability risk. What kind of liability exposures a corporate would have, which includes their management liability, by another product called directors and officers liability. It can mm-hmm. professional and professional liability exposure. Nickel or a company, contractor, architect would have a professional exposure. So it's a vertical zone, and cyber would fall within that vertical of liability. A corporate face liabilities or cost of which
okay, Mr. Arun, so you were saying about cyber insurance, right? Can you repeat that? There was a little choppiness in between.
Yeah, see, what I was mentioning is an organization typically would have different kind of risk exposure. For example, a large fire can impact their operation by damaging the plant assets or building, or they may have a business interruption exposure, like you would have seen now because of pandemic, they are unable to resume operation. There's another debate whether that is insurable or not, but still that's a exposure that they have. Likewise, and any organization would have a big exposure in terms of liabilities, starting from whether the management is exposed to liabilities, which is addressed by an insurance policy called directors and officers liability. Would they have a professional indemnity exposure? If they're an architect or an engineering firm, or they are into providing services, they may have legal challenges from their principal for defective or negligent delivery of services. Likewise, cyber liability or cyber exposure is one of the liability exposures which needs to be addressed by any corporate. Mm-hmm. As you know, most of the corporates are having a digital side of how they do business, whether it is in manufacturing or whether it is in commercial operations,
right,
or
right.
it is in or even in R&D, they have a lot of exposure on the digital side. Would they be facing any issues because of a cyber attack? And will that result in losses? And will that loss be even severe, made severe by it resulting being a liability challenge, maybe a civil suit or a demand for compensation filed by any of the agencies? So right. Cyber liability would fall within the stable of liability insurance products. And I would think that it is something which is taking off. It can take off very well. As you can see, after the COVID-19 impact, everybody has been able to reinvent themselves on the digital front.
Absolutely.
Are they able to keep their teams together? Are they able to keep their manufacturing intact? Are they able to keep logistics in place? There are businesses which are 100% dependent on online. So it's a new world out there. So I would Absolutely. Think that cyber insurance is much more relevant now than before.
Right. Sounds good. Yeah, very valid point that during COVID-19, it is an enabler for digitization. A lot of organizations are going online. Now, talking about the exposure. So is the cyber insurance only for bigger organizations? Because what we have seen in the industry is the SMBs are also getting attacked by cyber criminals. It is not that
right.
cyber criminals go after the Cognizant of the world or big five or bigger companies, but they also target the smaller organizations as well. Now, the cyber
yeah.
insurance, is it only for big corporate giants, or even the SMBs should also consider buying a cyber insurance?
I would think that it is relevant for organizations of all sizes. I'll give an example. Today, the biggest element of threat is espionage from across the border. Cross-border espionage, industrial espionage is a major worry. I may be a small contract research firm for pharma industry. I may be developing molecule for a principal, a large principal. I have valuable scientific data with me, which can be just copied, and then my leverage can be made completely redundant. I may be a manufacturer supplying to large principal, let's say in Europe or US. And if there is another company in my own line who are able to access my corporate information, they'll be able to take over my clients and my market. That's a kind of reality SMBs would face. Right. The main reason SMBs should look at it very seriously is they're not going to invest in millions in cybersecurity. They're not going to have best of their budget resources or for only right. cybersecurity. They may not have put in place all the mitigations or redundancies that are required. So I would think that SMBs are as important to look at cyber insurance than anybody else. And their ability to absorb a loss is much, much lesser than a large organization.
Absolutely.
Large with the deep pockets will be able to absorb. You know, a large IT firm had a ransomware attack.
Right, right.
They had, but it won't bring down the roof. Whereas a much smaller firm, if this happens, would have less and less ability to absorb such an event and the financial loss that they would face.
Right, makes sense. I mean, you're very right in saying that, okay, they will not be able to bear the loss because they're a small shop and this will have an impact on their bottom line and everything. Now, talking about getting a cyber insurance or buying it. So can I just open my browser, go to one website and then just buy the cyber insurance? Because I've seen there are portals which are offering various policies, like you can buy a healthcare policy or a car policy. So similarly, can I just go over there, fill in detail and buy cyber insurance? Is it like that?
As of now, I'm not able to see a possibility for that on two counts. Mm-hmm. I've not seen somebody yet offer cyber insurance online, like a commoditized motor insurance or a life insurance or a health insurance or a travel insurance. It's not yet. Mm-hmm. In general, you would see that corporate insurance needs a careful understanding of risk. Mm-hmm. Both by the customer and the insurer, the understanding mm-hmm. of risk is very important. It can't be commoditized. I'll give an example. Mm-hmm. I know organizations who have a traditional way of doing banking. Mm-hmm. They're a manufacturer or retailer. The way they do banking transactions is traditional. At best, they may have a corporate account in which they can have access to just view their account. Even fund transfer, they may not do online. That's a traditional mm-hmm. you can say old-fashioned way of doing your business. You're not exploited technology to its completeness. And then I know another organization who is using what is called host-to-host facility, which means the customer uses SAP, and every day they have to make payments to hundreds of vendors. They just take a text file from SAP, and then they put it in a folder in their own PC. It gets replicated automatically with the server of the bank. Mm-hmm. And the customer is able to make payments together. They can look at 100 vendors on their bank login by just right. clicking on which vendor they have to make payment. The payment goes on. They are much attractive targets for hackers, because if they are able to hack the login credentials, then you can take over the account. Absolutely. So you have these two extremes of what customers are doing. So number right. one reason why you cannot buy cyber insurance online is mm-hmm. your risk is very unique. You have customers who are dependent on their own IT systems, and then there are customers who have their entire existence on cloud. There is a customer right. who was telling me, I don't need any cyber insurance because my SAP is on cloud. My mm-hmm. billing software, I have 500 stores, my billing right. software is on cloud. And mm-hmm. even our user files are on Google Drive. So if mm-hmm. a hacker comes in, there's nothing that he can steal. What's his Outlook? Right. For which my explanation was, all the hacker needs is your login credentials.
That's it.
Of your cloud accounts. Then as far as your business is concerned, he replaces you. He becomes the owner of all your information assets.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So there may be a gap in thinking or gap in realization for customers in understanding their own risk. Right. This is half the story. The remaining story is insurers should have a proper understanding. Mm-hmm. Today, responsible insurers worldwide would not be willing to accept your risk for cyber insurance without looking at what is your BCP. They would ask for your business continuity plan. They would want to look at your disaster recovery plan. They may ask you, do you have an IT security policy? If it's a larger concern, they may ask, if it's a larger entity, they may ask, do you have mm-hmm. a cyber security policy? They would ask you, do you do VAPT? What is the frequency of VAPT? Mm-hmm. And then they would ask you, what is the outcome of the last VAPT? Were there any adverse remarks in the VAPT? Did you address it?
Mm-hmm.
You know, an insurer, as a responsible cyber insurer, want to look at what is the unique exposure that you may have as an individual customer.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
For that reason, is that why cyber insurance you may not be buying online.
Right. So what do you recommend? I mean, let's say some company wants to buy an insurance. So do they go to a broker or do they go to a insurance company directly? What do you advise on that?
The my take will be because I need to reiterate this aspect so that everybody is able to figure out the importance of that. Any insurance policy is good as long as the risk is understood correctly.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Any insurance policy is very bad if the insurance is finalized without understanding of risk.
Right.
I would think that any corporate insurance, not only cyber, whether it's a fire mm-hmm. insurance for the factory or cargo insurance for transit, or even your health insurance for your large group of employees, right. You would not write your own prescription. You can't be your own doctor. You would take professional help, not for placing the policy first. You will take professional help to understand your own risk. Mm-hmm. I would think that broker's value addition today is to help you understand your own risk mm-hmm. from the perspective of insurance. And having understood the risk, that means customer himself understands risk better because the broker is able to explain it better. Right. And find ways to transfer that risk into insurance policies. I think that's a very critical role a broker would face. So my recommendation is never buy an insurance policy directly from an insurance company. Not that it is bad, because an insurer may not have played the complete role of understanding what is unique about your own risk.
Makes sense.
And advising you correctly what kind of coverage you should buy, which only a broker can do.
Makes sense. So let's say I engage a broker, right? Without even, let's say, engaging a broker, what as an organization or what is a responsibility of a CISO, let's say, what they can do to prepare their organization before they embark on a journey for buying a cyber insurance? What all they can do to prepare themselves?
Great question, Vikas. I think last year or the year before, I met a pharmaceutical bulk drug company. They have a 2000 crore turnover bulk drug and formulation company. They invited me to make a presentation on cyber, and there was a discussion with their finance and IT team. And at the end of the presentation, this discussion started. The same question that you had asked was asked by the CFO. I found out to my shock, in spite of being a 2000 crore pharmaceutical and a bulk drug company and having a DCS in their plant, they have a industrial control system implemented in the plant, not now, 25 years ago. They are a very mature organization. And at the time I made a presentation to them on cyber, they did not have BCP.
Oh, okay.
Documented BCP absent, mm-hmm. then documented DR plan absent. They didn't have an IT security policy. To me, I was quite surprised that an organization which is quite mature and grown did not put priority on preparing themselves with this. So these documents are not for sake of insurance. These Absolutely. Documents are for their own hygiene, you know, their own security welfare, which they think they. So my point is putting in place these processes before you go for insurance is very essential, because a cyber underwriter would rate you based on this. Makes An underwriter sense. Is going to fix a premium based mm-hmm. on are your systems secure enough so that mm-hmm. it can withstand the first level of attack.
Right.
Or is it totally exposed to hackers? Right. So it's going to, these kind of preparations are going to decide, number one, is your policy going, if your proposal going to be accepted? Number two, will you get a friendly premium price from the underwriters?
Right. Makes sense. So let me ask this. So cyber insurance company coming to you, you know, evaluating your exposure and everything, and then setting up a price or a whatever, you know, they have to charge. So are there any organizations who can come and prepare you to get the cyber insurance, or it is the role of a broker? So you engage with a broker comes to your organization, you know, sits with management, understand your risk, and then tells you what you need to do before you even go to a cyber insurance company and buy an insurance. Are there such services available?
No, a broker can do most of this. What a broker cannot do, because mm-hmm. what the broker cannot do is he cannot replace the security hierarchy in an organization. The cyber Absolutely. Security hierarchy, a broker can, because broker cannot pretend to be a security professional. He can't.
Right, right.
What a broker is very good is to understand your risk. He's going to ask you questions about, like I asked, all the answers that I get from a customer is based on the question that I ask.
Right.
I ask them, what is your business? I ask them, how much of it is dependent upon your IT interest? Are you totally dependent on IT like an online platform? What part of your business is dependent upon IT?
Right.
Right. That will help me to understand the risk. And then I'm going to check with you whether you have the necessary information or documentation available, which will be identified, which will be demanded by an underwriter.
Right. Makes sense.
Right. I'm going to check with you. Do you have a BCP? Do you have a DR plan? Do you have a IT security policy? Right. If you are a larger organization, do you have a cyber security policy? I'm going to tell you what is the expectation of an underwriter so that you appear to be a good risk.
Absolutely.
The example that I gave you was an example of being a bad risk for an underwriter.
Absolutely.
So you don't have anything in place.
Right. So is there, let me ask this. Is there a template or set of questions that we can share with CISOs or our listeners? They can go through those questions, understand what they're doing right now, and what is that gap?
Yeah.
So they can do some kind of baselining, prepare themselves to an extent. So when the broker comes, they have all this information handy. It is available.
Yeah.
And it can certainly speed up the entire process, because I'm sure during this COVID-19 time, a lot of organizations would like to take a cyber insurance. So is there any toolkit that you may recommend that CISOs can use?
Yeah, so the usual documentation for us to prepare as a kit for a submission to an insurer would be, number one, a proposal form, right? A proposal form which will have a questionnaire, an additional questionnaire, which will bring out information about your risk. It will ask questions about your static IPs, and it will ask question about your business, especially where there is a dependence about to be online. It will ask question, have you taken server, have you given server access to your vendors? Will be a very important question. It will also ask, have you taken server access from your principal? So that you will have liability tomorrow if something happens on your side. So proposal form is a key document which will help a CISO to figure out what are the expectations of an insurance company. Number two, as I listed out already, the cybersecurity documentation that you should be having, not only because you are going to be insured, but because you need it for your own requirement, like BCP and DR plan, IT security policy, will be a requirement to be shared with the insurance companies. Number three, we have a checklist which we can give share with you, which you can share with the CISOs. That checklist will be a good thing to check out before we decide to go for insurance.
Wonderful.
Checklist,
that will be great. So once we upload this video on our website, I will put that template as well, so that anybody going through our podcast can benefit from that. Oh, that's great.
Correct.
So all you said, I think I can relate with the standards of ISO 27001 for ISMS and ISO 22301 for BCPDR. So organization can choose to go for these standards, which will help them prepare a lot of documentation, right? So your policy will be available, your DR BCP plan will be available, so that you would have a lot of documentation already available to share when you go for the insurance, right? So perfect. Now, talking about the insurance and the cost it is going to, the companies are going to incur. So what decides the premium? What decides the overall cost that company is going to spend on buying a cyber insurance?
Yeah, typically, this is a process of underwriting. Underwriting would be the opportunity an insurer would have to first assess your risk, right? Number one. Number two, to decide whether he is going to accept your risk after a proper understanding of your risk. And number three, how to price the risk, particularly as applicable to you as an organization. Number four will be, should there be any safeguards an insurance company would like to keep? For example, should he keep a higher deductible or a lower deductible? Should he give a particular extension in the policy or not? All that will be what an underwriter would do. For that, the parameter usually, the first parameter that as an underwriter I would look at is, what is your sector in business? Mm-hmm. Are you a bank? Are you an NBFC? Are you an IT company? Are you a pharma company? Are you a manufacturing company? What's your sector would decide how they look at their appetite? Because there are cyber insurers in the market who decide to accept a particular type of risk and they decide to reject other risk. Cyber insurers who are very good for manufacturing companies and pharma companies will take a decision that this year we will not be underwriting banks.
Okay.
You know, there are the increasing right. number of incidents affecting banks. Absolutely. Let's say we have a cyber insurance product filed with the regulator. We have capacity, right. let's say $30 million or $40 million. We right. can give a friendly pricing. We have the capability to understand risk, mm-hmm. cyber risk. Mm-hmm. But excuse me, your customer is a bank, so we won't be the insurers for banks.
Oh, wow.
Likewise, there are insurers who will say, we'd like to not underwrite IT companies or ITES okay. companies.
Okay.
Because the market incidents will change the posture of insurers. If they suddenly see a big loss, a big ransomware attack of a global IT major, mm-hmm. if the organization is already providing cybersecurity services, themselves are right. affected by a ransomware.
Yeah, yeah.
Correct?
True.
It slightly changed the perspective right. for an underwriter also. He is also a human being.
Absolutely.
So number one is the sector in which you operate will decide the premium rate. Because mm-hmm. number right. two, what is the limit that you're asking for? Are you asking for mm-hmm. $1 million coverage? Or coverage would mean a limit of indemnity. What is the limit of the insurer mm-hmm. under the policy? What is the limit you are looking for? Is it $1 million? Is it $5 million? Is it $10 million? Is it $50 million? Is it $100 million? Will decide the pricing.
Right.
In terms of how much you will be incurring. If you take a lower limit, you'll be obviously paying a lower premium, as yeah. a premium payment. Number three will be these priorities in terms of cybersecurity preparedness. Mm-hmm. As I told you the example earlier, an organization, maybe their turnover is 2000 crores, but they don't have a BCP or DR plan in place, will be not so welcome risk.
Right.
Ultimately, somebody who wants to insure them will not be giving them a friendly pricing because their systems are already vulnerable to an attack.
Right. Makes sense. Makes
number
sense.
Four.
Yeah.
Number four, a very important point I will mention, Vikas, is what has been the history? What is your track record?
Right. Makes
Did
sense.
You have? Are you having too many incidents in your system which you are reporting, which tells the underwriter that your systems are not okay? Mm-hmm. Did you have a large incident which you had to report as it could have become a big claim?
Right.
So
right.
your sector, the limit that you are buying, mm-hmm. your cybersecurity preparedness, and mm-hmm. your loss history or your incident history. Largely, there could be a few other parameters, but these are the large influencers of premium pricing an underwriter would charge.
Makes sense. So let's say I go through entire exercise, right? Organization goes through entire exercise and they get a cyber insurance. Now, after getting a cyber insurance, is it like that, okay, I have taken an insurance. Now I don't have to take care of anything. I have outsourced my responsibility. So I can do whatever I want. Whenever there's an attack happens, I can go to a cyber insurer or underwriter and I can claim the amount. Is it what you see in the industry, or is it a right mindset, or how does cyber insurance companies deal with this kind of attitude? Okay, I have an insurance, I am okay now. Anything happens, I can file a claim.
I need to answer this question in two things. It's a very, very important question that you asked.
Right.
I have to answer it in three ways. Number one, there is a larger overarching principle in insurance, not only cyber insurance, even your factory insurance or your any insurance that you buy. The insurer or the underwriter would expect that you behave as though you're uninsured.
Oh, okay.
Suppose you didn't have an insurance policy, how will you behave? Will you not secure your factory by a security guard? Will you not keep CCTVs in your premises to protect your right. premises? Will you not keep fire extinguishing appliances? Whether you're insured or not, will you not keep?
Absolutely.
Or just because you have an insurance policy, you can do anything, not appoint security guards, not have firefighting. Right. You will never do. As a responsible businessman, you will never do that.
Right.
Likewise, in cyber insurance, you have informed through the proposal mm-hmm. form that these are the certifications that I keep. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You have informed through the proposal form, these are the processes that I follow. Mm-hmm. I'm talking about the business process. For example, right. at the time of taking insurance, you never gave server access to our vendors. Mm-hmm. You never gave direct access to vendors to your servers. Correct?
Right.
Then 6 months later, your business model changed and maybe you introduced a new process or you started a new division, which compels you to give access to vendors into your server. You're going to give server access to vendors. That changes the material factor for acceptance by the insurer. Correct? Right. You're supposed to keep the insurer informed.
Right.
There is a certification that you followed. For example, PCI DSS. You took accreditation, you incurred money, you had an audit, and then you have a PCI DSS accreditation. Mm-hmm. 6 months later or next year when you renewed the policy, you allowed the accreditation to expire. Mm-hmm. You're supposed to mention it correctly in the proposal form.
Makes sense.
Number three, you had incidents that happened. You had some attack, mm-hmm. you had some exposure, you had incidents. You're supposed mm-hmm. to inform that to the insurance company then and there.
Right.
You cannot keep it yourself and then not disclose.
Very, very valid point. I wanted to talk about this as well. So yes, you have taken insurance and everything, and you are doing your due diligence. You are keeping your security control up to date. Even then, attack happens, right? So let's talk about two scenarios. One is the ransomware attack, which is happening all the time. And second is data leak, right? If a data leak happens, your PII data goes into the public domain, and under GDPR also you are covered. So how do you handle these two situations? Do you inform the regulator first, or do you go to an insurance company and inform the insurance company first, or you have to do all this in parallel? So what do people do? What does the organization do after the incident? How does that situation plays up?
See, there are two ways. There are two important dimensions to this. The first dimension is, are you governed by a legislation which will expect you to immediately inform the authorities? Are you governed by, in India, do you have a legislation today to compel insurers to immediately inform and then have a breach notification to customers? There's a credit monitoring that they should do. Maybe we don't have the similar legislation we will see in the Western markets, like in Europe or US. Today in India, we have. When the Data Protection Act comes into, or the Private Data Protection Act comes into force, you may look at those things coming in. So the first dimension is, forget insurance. As a law-abiding corporate entity, what are your duties? You have to do that. If that requires immediate notification to authorities, you are supposed to do that. Today, if you are a bank, you are supposed to immediately notify the Reserve Bank of India if there is a compromise impacting the cyber security infrastructure of the bank. And definitely, if it's going to impact customers, you're supposed to notify Reserve Bank immediately. Likewise, every regulator have the regulatory requirement of notifying the regulator, which you have to carry out. There's no escape, right? Nobody will excuse for not informing. But the advantage of keeping a broker like us and through us, this insurer, to be immediately informed, today the value addition in a cyber insurance is quite a few insurers offer first level legal assistance.
Okay.
They tie up with law firms, and then the insurer's value addition is they will help you to connect with the law firm, so the first level legal advice you will get.
Okay.
If you are confused about even compliance of your legal duties as an entity in terms of notification or reporting, the law firm who will be conversant with your country's legislation or the countries where you operate, they will be able to advise you what you should be doing in terms of compliance and reporting. That's a very, very important value addition. So,
quick question on this one. Is it something which is add-on, you have to pick and choose while you are buying a policy, or this is a standard offering that everybody gets?
It's like this. When you buy a car, there are cars which have a music set and there are cars which don't have.
Right.
There's a car with automatic gear and you have another car with manual gear. You have a sunroof or you don't have a sunroof, right?
Right.
It's a choice of what kind of policy form that you buy and a choice of which insurer you choose.
Right.
So there are insurers who don't provide this value addition. There are insurers who provide. There's more than one insurer who provides this value addition.
Wonderful.
Number one. Number two, similar to this legal advice, because insurers also provide first level assistance of forensic investigators.
I was coming to that. That was my second question. Okay. Can we pick and choose? Okay. Forensic and then legal, maybe media handling, all those things. So there are various options available. That's what I understand, right?
Yeah. So it's not a menu card. You have an insurance company A. You ultimately decide that their pricing is okay, their deductibles are friendly, their coverage is very good. You sign up with them. You will upfront know if you become their customer, when an incident happens, which is the law firm you'll be talking to, you'll know upfront when you buy the policy. You'll also know upfront which is a forensic investigator you'll be dealing with when you buy the policy. They'll disclose you upfront.
Makes sense.
If God forbid an incident happens, you'll be able to connect with those agencies and take first level help.
Makes sense.
Right?
Right. So, okay, we have taken insurance. We understand all these things. Now, incident happens, and then you get to a point where you have to raise a claim with the agency. How easy it is to get the claim? Is it like, okay, you fill the form? What is the process? So they will come, the insurance company will come and conduct the analysis and then decide how much claim is justified, how much you are liable for, or how does that process work? Is it easy or it is too difficult?
Very interesting question. If I know it should not happen to you, but if I bang my car, I have an accident, it's not going to be easy, correct? Suppose I run over somebody, I have to go through police process, correct? No insurance claim is going to be pleasant. The first level of unpleasantness is that such an incident happened to you. It's a very unpleasant incident to experience. Second thing is, ultimately, because all of us should realize we are dealing with an insurance contract, correct? It's an insurance contract. The insurance contract has put obligations on both sides. What are the obligations of the insurer? Is he has to indemnify you for your losses. Secondly, there are obligations cast on the customer that you need to follow these kind of requirements to be eligible for a claim. So the first realization is you are dealing with a contract. You have an incident that has happened. You are a very wise and well-informed customer. So you know that you have to intimate to the insurance company. So you will notify if I'm the broker placing it, will first inform me. Then I will assist you to figure out in what manner we should report the claim. Then what happens? As per the insurance regulations in India, as per the Insurance Act, there will be a surveyor who will be appointed. A surveyor, insurance surveyor, is an independent third-party professional who will be required to assess the loss. It's not the insurance company who will decide the loss. They cannot because they are a contracting party. They would require the loss has to be by an independent surveyor. Recent changes in the insurance regulation has given some kind of leeway for insurance companies to decide about deciding on the losses. But this kind of leverage is very difficult to consider for cyber insurance because of its specialization and technicality. So I would think today when you report a claim, the first thing insurance company would do is to appoint an insurance surveyor and a loss assessor. Usually what I found, even the surveyor or loss assessor is not an IT professional. He is not a cyber security professional. He is not an information security professional. He may be taking assistance from external subject matter experts, but he is the registered, he is the IRDA registered professional who will tell you if your loss is 1 crore, whether you will be getting 1 crore or not, will be essentially assessed by a IRDA licensed insurance surveyor. So he is a very critical component to getting a claim successfully. So he may be having documentary requirements. He may be having documentary requirements. Then he may be seeking data from you. He may be seeking logs from you. He may even agree with you that you can engage a forensic investigator of your choice. And he may be insisting on the forensic investigator's report. And he may be seeking financial information from you as to what are the costs that you incurred to get back your system. If there's going to be a third-party liability, you may have to share all the communications with the surveyor. So the existence of an insurance surveyor is something that we should be quite aware of. And it is based on his report, an insurance company will pay the claim to you. So that would already given you an idea that an insurance claim is not a very simple process. It is a very detailed process. I won't say it's a complex process, but it's detailed a detailed process. You should be willing to go through it. If you want to apply for a home loan, you know how much documentation you have to prepare?
Absolutely, absolutely.
Right? You're not feeling bad about it. You know, to get a successful loan, you need to comply with documentation.
Absolutely.
It's the same. That's an analogy.
Great, great insights, Mr. Arun. We are overshooting the time because we want to keep this podcast short. But interesting discussions. But let me ask this last question. What goes in the gray lines, right? In between the lines that we do not understand while buying a cyber insurance policy for the organizations, what CISOs should be careful about, though it may be a legal, legal will be involved and all. But from a CISO perspective, what
Yeah.
What gray line item you should be careful of?
Yeah. So I need to give the example of cars again. Forgive me, Vikas. You want to buy a car, you have a choice. You can buy a car with all four doors are manual operated doors. You know, you don't have, you can buy a car with a music system, without music system. So you choose what product you buy. Likewise, in cyber insurance, the policy form will decide how much coverage is available to you, number one. So the, if there are, let's say, half a dozen insurers in India who offer a cyber insurance policy, their forms are not same. There are unique differences in the cyber form that they follow. So a CISO should be aware of possible nuances or uniqueness of a particular policy form. I'll give an example. There are some policy forms which will cover even financial loss of the organization, not just cost. Because cyber insurance is nothing but first party cost and third party liability. If it's a cyber liability insurance world over, what you see is a first party cost, which means cost you incur to get back your system, cost you incur for breach management, and cost you incur for engaging a forensic investigator. There's only cost.
Right.
But if a hacker is able to take money from your account, from the organization's bank account, that is a financial loss. Typical cyber insurance form doesn't cover that. But there are insurance policies which cover by default financial loss also.
Say
a responsible would know that if I buy the policy form of company A, B and C, it doesn't cover financial loss. But if I buy the cyber insurance using the policy form B and E, it also includes financial loss.
Makes sense. Very, very, very valid point. So I hit with a ransomware. Somebody gets hit with a ransomware, not me. Okay. And then they do not have a backup and they have to pay hackers in bitcoins. Is that amount, and let's say it's a hefty amount, is it insured? Or while taking a policy, can we say that, okay, whatever amount we are going to pay, let's say in bitcoin or whatever format it is to hackers, that could be reimbursed, that could be claimed?
See, the basic ingredient of a contract, because you will know, is it is for a legal object. That's an ingredient. Among the two ingredients of a valid contract, the contract should be for a legal object, right?
Right.
It should not be, so for example, I cannot insure myself. I'm going to smuggle red sand as wood and I want to insure it. Can I do that? I can't. Correct? the illegality aspect cannot be part of the insurance coverage. But having said that, the cyber insurance policy form would cover your losses in case cyber extortion occurs. The jargon used in insurance is a ransomware attack happens. What you're facing is a cyber extortion. Okay. Your systems are taken over somebody and the hacker is demanding money. So not all, many policy forms, cyber policy forms cover what is called a cyber extortion. That answers your question about the ransom money.
Right.
But going above that, your claim process also should be compliant within the law. Suppose the local law prevents ransom being paid. If there is a specific rule or a legal provision, ransom payment is illegal. Even if the insurance company is willing to pay, it may become illegal for you to pay ransom. So that it depends what kind of jurisdiction you are covered. Does the local law permit payment of ransom or not?
Absolutely.
Which is why I hear say secondary stories that ransom is always paid offshore.
Right.
You don't pay from your account, you don't pay from your country, it is handled offshore.
Right.
Correct?
So, absolutely.
That's how we will overcome that. But to answer your question, the cyber extortion coverage of cyber policy would take care of this ransom issue.
Right. I mean, there are a lot of points to discuss, but this podcast would convert into a webinar otherwise. Any parting thoughts that you would like to recommend the audience if they want to take a cyber insurance? Any step-by-step closing remarks for them?
Yeah, my suggestion is if you have not considered cyber insurance at all, I know your worry is about the security of the organization and possible loss of information or data and its financial impact. So as you would worry about the factory insurance or any other insurance, cyber insurance should be a key priority for the organization. And nobody is better suited than a CISO to bring focus to the management on this. So CISOs would play a very, very key role to do this. Number two, never be your own doctor. If you got a serious problem on health, you will go to a competent doctor. So I would suggest that prescribing your own medicine, take professional help. If you have a legal problem, you take a lawyer. If you got an auditing problem, a tax problem, you go to a chartered accountant. If you have a health issue, you go to a doctor. If there is a risk management and insurance issue, please choose the services of a good broker. You will never regret it. Definitely, it will be of a lot of value for you. It will give you, it will help you to get perspective and possibly do the job right. You will end up doing the job, but you will be able to do it the job right with Absolutely. The assistance of a good broker.
Great. Right? Sounds good. Sounds
thirdly,
good, yeah.
Thirdly is slightly not to be on the surface. Slightly go a little deeper into understanding the policy forms. Mm-hmm. You know, what policy form will get you, what kind of coverage. Definitely, again, a broker would come in to help you figure out which policy form is right. You should never think that all cyber insurance are the same. They are not.
Absolutely. Yeah. Great. Great. Great insights, Mr. Arun. Thanks a lot. I'm sure a lot of people are going to get benefit out of it because the awareness is not there. That's what I think. So this podcast, I'm sure, going to help a lot of people get the basics clear. And with your template, we will post it on the YouTube and the website of Elite CISO, and then people can watch it from there. Great. Thanks a lot for joining us. Thank you.
I wish Elite CISO all the best. Thank you very much.